Caruso.
Here.
Gudana.
Here.
Kafuchi.
Here.
Montalbano.
Here.
Sheldon.
Here.
Higgins.
Here.
Milano.
Yeah.
Del Gershia.
Here. Everyone please stand for Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Madam Secretary, votes of this meeting have been given according to the Sunshine Law?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, notice of this meeting has been given to the public in the press reporting of the open public meeting was out.
Okay. Has everybody read the minutes for last month? Anyone have any additions, subtractions, anything wrong with them? Can I have a motion to approve the minutes?
Make a motion.
Motion made by Mr. Caruso, seconded by Mr. Montalbano. Clerk, call the roll, please.
Caruso. Gudana.
Yes.
Kafuchi.
Yes.
Montalbano.
Yes.
Sheldon.
Yes.
Del Gershia.
Yes.
Milano.
Yes.
Okay. Applications for adjournment.
Chairman, counsel's name is Robert Cassione. I represent the last two applicants on the list, and in view of the fact it's unlikely they were going to be reached, I discussed with my client their concerns about time, and they both would like to have a special meeting.
Together?
That's Sonners and Empire Medical.
All right. Do you want to have it together? To both?
Together, I think. Yes.
Gentlemen, you still have your list of dates for this month? You don't have your list? Okay, I'll give you the dates. Friday the 11th, Monday the 14th, Tuesday the 15th, Friday the 18th, Monday the 21st, Tuesday the 22nd, Monday the 28th, and Tuesday the 29th. Anybody have a preference for any of these dates?
Some Mondays, we can't make some Mondays.
Some Mondays. Can you make any of these Mondays?
Second, third, and
you got
fourth.
One? The second?
Second, third, and fourth, we can't make.
Second, third, and fourth. Well, that's all the Mondays.
That reference is a Tuesday.
Huh?
That reference is a Tuesday.
A Tuesday?
No, Tuesday's good.
Tuesday's good.
I think the 15th is one of the Tuesdays.
Yes. 15th is good. No good for you?
As of now, no.
No good for our turn. 29th is good. Anybody with 29th?
On the 22nd, right?
Or the 22nd?
22nd would be very good with me. I have conflict with a couple of those dates. I'd have to get a replacement.
Is that your busy season, Joe?
Huh?
Is that your busy season?
Mine?
Mr. Cassidy,
I'm very bubble.
29th is a problem with me. I will have to get somebody else to cover.
No Fridays, Joe?
No.
No Fridays. Okay. Fridays are out. 22nd? All right, then 22nd?
Tuesday.
Anybody problem for him on the 22nd? No?
Tuesday?
Yeah, Tuesday. Okay?
Have you noticed for this meeting?
Yes.
She says it's a town meeting.
The 22nd. How's that sound, Mr. Gashian?
That's fine with me. Thank you.
Huh? That's a Tuesday. Tuesday the 22nd. Okay, anyone else looking for an adjournment?
So, Mr. Chairman, those two cases will be adjourned without further notice to 7 p.m. on the 22nd of December.
For everybody in the audience.
That's good in the paper, too.
Well, yes.
Mr. Chairman, do you want Mr. Rego to approve the notices that were sent out for tonight's meeting?
Yeah, we should. They want to renotice.
All right, well, you're doing that. Well, I have to wait until you do that. Because if there's a problem, then there's another problem. So. But nobody else is looking for an adjournment. Okay. That's
December 22nd.
Well, it's not January. No. December 22nd, Tuesday. Put it in your cell phone. Put it on the wall.
Chairman, while we're waiting on our attorney, we have another adjournment that we'll stop.
Okay, I heard somebody else was adjourning something. Okay, we have a communication on, let's see, ZB 2015-20, that's number 5 on our agenda. That's an applicant is proposing to construct a two-family dwelling on an existing vacant lot at 3335 Jefferson Street. The letter was dated December 2nd. Dear Chairman and Board Members, the above matter is listed for your agenda for December 3rd, 2015. Based upon our position on the agenda and the nature of the applications being heard before our client's application, it appears we will not be reached. Accordingly, it is requested that the matter be carried to the January 7th, 2016 Zoning Board meeting, and that no further notice will be required of the applicant. The applicant waives the time of the decision. Please enjoy the holidays. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year's to all of you and your staff. Sincerely, Frank J. Cazzarelli for Enrique Alvarez.
January 7th. Mr. Chairman, I did review the notice and publication for numbers 7 and 8. They're appropriate.
Okay, so let's go over this. ZB 2015-20, Alvarez, 3335 Jefferson Street, is adjourned to January 7th. And number 7 on the agenda, ZB 2015-27, Sonners, 530 Washington Avenue. The applicant is proposing a flower shop on the north part of the building adjacent to Papa John's. That will be adjourned. Well, let's do the first one first. The first one is adjourned. I said the 7th. There'll be no further notices for Alvarez either in the newspaper or by mail. And as far as number 7, that is being heard at a special meeting on Tuesday, the 22nd of December, together with ZB 2015-28, Empire Medical Management Limited Liability, it's either company or corporation, 195 Cortland Street. Applicant is proposing to alter the existing vacant two-story building into medical offices for Empire Medical Associates. There is no increase in the footprint of the building. On the second floor, they will be relocating their offices from 5 Franklin Avenue. Part of the first floor will have an urgent care center for non-life-threatening care on a walk-in basis. Both of those will be for the special meeting on Tuesday, the 22nd of December. There will be no further notices either in the mail or in the newspaper, and that will be heard at 7 p.m. our usual time.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Anything else before we move on? No. Okay. Then, to start this agenda, I would like to start this with a case that we started last month and didn't finish, if they're in the audience, and that is ZB 2015-26, the estate of A. Molinaro, 37 Berkeley Avenue.
Yes, present.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. My name is Michael DeMarco. I'm with the office of DeMarco and DeMarco, 912 Belmont Avenue, Heldon. I represent the applicant, the estate of Anthony Molinaro. We were here at the at last month's meeting seeking a certification for a non-conforming use, specifically to continue the use of the property as a two-family home. My father, who I practiced with, Patrick DeMarco, was here. He was covering for me that night, and he advised that the board had raised the question as to whether the use was permitted either by the 1947 ordinance or by the 1955 ordinance. I had the opportunity to review the ordinances, and it appears as though the use was permitted by virtue of the 1947 ordinance, and then it wasn't until the 1955 ordinance that A residences or dwellings in the A resident zones were limited to a one-family home. At the last hearing, we presented evidence through the Office of the Tax Assessor confirming that this property was in use since at least 1955 as a two-family home and was taxed as such. I would rely upon the provision, the 1955 ordinance, It's found at section six, which states that any non-conforming use that's existing at the time of the passage of the ordinance may be continued. Additionally, when we were here last, the board had raised a question as to how the property was metered. The two units are separately metered for electric, and each has a separate electrical.
Did you take pictures of that or anything?
I do have pictures of the.
Any evidence, please provide it to us, and we'll mark that in evidence. Our attorney will handle that. Because the more evidence that you provide, the better the application.
I don't believe anything was marked last time, so I would mark this.
No, nothing was.
Right. No, we had, A1 was the proof of notice and service, and A2 was the property record card.
Okay.
So A3 will be whatever.
A3 is a picture of the separate electrical meters.
And did you indicate when that was taken and who took it?
Yes, that was taken by me this past Monday. And the two meters as reflected on A3 accurately depict the condition of the meters as existed this past Monday when I took the picture.
Okay.
A4 and A5 respectively are pictures of the front door of the residence, which services only the first floor, and A5 is a picture of the side door, which services the second unit, so each of the dwellings have separate means of ingress and egress. Last but not least, I have A7, which depicts it.
Six.
A6.
Oh, that was in A5?
Four.
Oh, four, five, I'm sorry. Getting ahead of myself. A6 is a picture of the detached two-car garage, which shows that there is, in addition to the driveway, ample off-street parking servicing the two units. And again, all of these pictures were taken by me this past Monday and accurately depict the condition of the property as it had been. The board may or may not recall that the tax records that were marked, I believe as A2 or A3, confirm that the building permit was obtained for the construction of that detached two-car garage.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
I'm seeing two sets of a garage. Is the left one?
The left one services 37 Berkeley. It's a shared driveway arranged with the neighboring property. Yeah, there's an easement there.
There is an easement.
Yes, sir. So.
Any other pictures?
No, there are no other pictures.
Could you split this one?
Sure.
Mr. De Lorenzo, I'd like to have this sworn in.
You raise your right hand. In regard to this application, you swear the testimony you're about to give, sir, the truth, so.
Yes, sir.
Just state your name, your last name, and your position.
Frank, I asked you to check if there was any of the adjoining properties also listed as a two-family, if they were similar to this, but I know that when I went by, there's at least one property that looks almost identical to it. I think it's the one on the right.
No, 34, 35, 25, and 21 are all legal twos, and the one next door, or I believe it's 41, that's a two-family by the tax rule.
It is a two-family by the tax rule?
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions anybody has? Any questions, members of the board? Anybody wish to give testimony from the audience on this case or ask questions on this case? No? Then I'll leave it up to the board. Your pleasure, gentlemen. Huh? And lady, yes. Well, the lady is going to be voting, but she's number eight. Right? Three, four, five, six, seven. Oh, you're not going to vote? All right, but she can vote, okay.
Why can't you vote?
I wasn't here last week.
Last month, but she was here last month. All right, then you can't vote. So, lady and gentlemen, can I? Your pleasure, go ahead.
Can I clarify something? I'm looking at my notes from last month. It would appear that the, The ordinance that prohibits the two-family use, which is what your client is seeking, was adopted in 1955.
That is correct.
In my notes from last year, no, from last month, it appears that it's been taxed as a two-family since 1955. It was built in 41 as a single-family?
Correct.
Okay.
According to the tax records.
We seem to be shaving it kind of close. When, prior to 1955, was this a two-family? We seem to go back to 55.
Right, the tax records show that for 1955 in its entirety, it was a two-family home. Okay. Again, this property was in Mrs. Molinaro's husband's family, you know, since the 40s. She testified that as long as she has been familiar with the Molinaro family, it's been used as a two-family home. But the tax records show for all of 1955, it was in fact taxed as a two-family.
And how about 54,
53? The tax records before that go back to the 40s show that it was a one-family before that, but it's unclear as to when the tax records changed.
Wait, I'm going to interject, because it says here, forward from 54, okay? And the taxes or the assessments were the same in 54, 55, and 56. The assessments did not change until 57. There might have been a reval in 57. That would explain it. But in 54 and in 55, the assessments are exactly identical.
That is correct.
So for one step further, and they are?
They are what?
They are assessed as?
Two-family.
You're not saying.
Oh, I'm sorry.
The assessment is the same.
Yeah, the assessment is the same. It indicates it's
and that's why we're talking about the ordinance of 1955,
yeah,
which we started that discussion last meeting, mm-hmm, and that's
correct.
Why he went back and did his homework and looked at. That's how that came about.
Okay. So, again, I'm going back to the board for their pleasure on this case. Does anybody wish to make a motion? All right, Mr. Volano is making a motion
to approve. Giving the evidence given, which we talked about last time. The ordinances that we looked at, always looked at, 59, I think it was 79 as well.
Correct.
So, obviously, this use pre-exists the ordinance. It was legal when it was being used. In 54, as a two-family, it became different after the use was established. And so, that's what we talked about last week. That's what we needed proof of. And that's what I believe we presented. So that's my rationale for making a motion to approve.
Second.
Okay, seconded by Mr. Giordano. Clerk, call the roll.
Giordano.
Yes.
Mafucci.
Yes.
Cabana.
Yes.
Sheldon.
Yes.
Higgins.
Yes.
Volano.
Yes.
Del Garcia.
Yes. Group 7 to nothing.
Thank you very much. Merry Christmas, sir.
You're welcome.
Thank
you. And now we will go to our next case on the agenda, ZB 2014-08. 138-146 Brighton Avenue, Calandra. Applicants propose to renovate existing apartment complex to add 8 additional one-bedroom units to the existing 33. The additional 8 units will be located on the lower level.
Let the record reflect that board member Mary Higgins is stepping down from this application.
Okay, all right. I was called up. When we left off, we had three by a board 6-1.
Excuse me. I can't hear.
Ladies and gentlemen, there will be quiet here or I will eject people. I want to get this application over with. Okay? Don't talk. You want to talk? Get up. Go out the hall. 2 other rules. Cell phones off or on vibration. Anyone who wishes to testify or ask questions or anything will come up to the front because we are being
this is the way we're doing things. We're having a videotape tonight. Okay? We want to keep a record of who's talking compared to the transcript.
The question was asked, what channel?
What channel? The town channel. Go to the town on the website and go to the zoning board and you will see the tape on your cell phone. Okay? All right. Now, as of 2 months ago, actually it was 2 months ago, at the October meeting, we agreed on a board by 6-1 vote to hire an independent surveyor to survey the property to get this question about how much property is involved and where the boundaries are over with once and for all, hopefully. Okay. Mr. Milano said he would... You said you would leave it up to me to hire somebody.
It's your agenda.
So
the
I
point said we
really I know, but it was your suggestion. Let's put it that way.
I said I had faith in the fact that you could pick somebody.
Yes.
And the board agreed.
And the board agreed. And I hired the firm of Mr. D'Onofrio, who has Mr. Angelo DeRose as his surveyor. And I believe he's a forensic surveyor. Mr. D'Onofrio, get up.
Or
swear both of them in.
Well, let me.
He's the engineer, okay. He's the surveyor. He works for him.
I want to ask Mr. Gassion, wherever he is.
I'm a lot shorter than you in the front of me.
Before we get to the surveyor, is your case significantly and substantially completed?
It was.
Okay. And my notes reflect that. After you completed your case, we had a number of comments and exhibits from the objectors.
That's the way I recall.
And that's the way we left it, and as the chairman indicated, there seemed to be an issue with regard to the property at the rear, and that's where we came into retaining an independent surveyor to take a look at that. So that's where we are. I just wanted to put it in focus.
I didn't agree at that time that there was an issue. However, obviously there has been a new survey done,
okay.
And I'll wait to hear the results.
Okay. Why don't we swear both you gentlemen in, one at a time. Could raise your right hand, please. With regard to this application, do you swear the testimony you're about to give shall be the truth itself you got?
I do.
And could you state your name and spell your last name, please?
John A. D'Onofrio, the apostrophe. Capital O-N-O-F-R-I-O.
And you're a licensed engineer?
Yes.
Licensed in anything else besides engineer?
I'm a retired licensed surveyor.
Okay.
Retired.
And Mr. DeRose, if you could raise your right hand, please, with regard to this application, do you swear the testimony that you're about to give, shall be the truth to help you God?
Yes, I do.
State your name, spell your last name, please.
My name is Angelo DeRose, D-E-R-O-S-E.
And you are a licensed surveyor in the state of New Jersey. How long have you been a licensed surveyor?
Since 1992.
Okay. Since our last meeting, Mr. D'Onofrio, I believe the chairman, approached you and asked you, I believe, to... What did he ask him to do?
He asked us to prepare a survey for the subject property, primarily because of the land shared border across the back with lands of the township, which were formerly the lands of the Morris Canal.
Okay. Did he indicate that this would be an independent survey? You weren't working for either party, you were assisting the board in trying to determine how much land at the rear of the property was actually in ownership by the applicant?
It was our understanding that our assignment was to be a neutral for the Board of Adjustment, and we took great pains not to contact either side.
Okay. And I'm assuming you've done municipal engineering before?
Yes.
And private as well?
Mostly private.
Mostly private. Mr. DeRose, with regard to your surveying background, are you mostly independent, mostly private, or both?
Pretty much both. I service contractors, I service companies, consultants to them. I've had my own business for a number of years in survey crews. And I, on my resume, I surveyed the Brooklyn Bridge to see if it's be a national monument, 18,000 acres of New Jersey pine lands, Madison Square Garden, Grand Central Station, the LIRR. Trying to spread my career.
Okay. Believe the board satisfied with the qualifications. Before you indicate the result of your surveying, could you explain to the board what you did, what you considered, what you looked at, how many times you're on the property, those kinds of things?
Yeah, I'm going to have Mr. DeRosio.
Is he in the right spot to be heard by everyone?
Well, you know what? Move more here so that way they can see you on the video better.
It's better?
Yeah. That should be okay.
What did you do?
We were provided documentation that apparently came from the other surveyors, the applicant. I took that in, I created a mosaic, I plotted them. Upon reading them, I saw there was other information I wanted. I went to the tax assessor's office. The ladies there were very kind. They gave me the surrounding deeds that I asked for. What was then missing, I plotted those. Then from there, what was missing, I went to Newark. And I started pulling the historical documentation for this. I was obtained documentation, went back as far as 1897, the furniture of the property, 1932 tax map. This is all in the public domain. Anybody who wishes to obtain it, all you got to do is get up, go to county seat, all there. It's only 5 cents a copy, too. Pretty reasonable. From that, once I had that, then I went upon the ground, and I literally recovered any and all physical evidence I could find. Iron pipes, property corners, fence lines, splitting curves, all of that. I made measurements of the building, and I literally took measurements to the fence lines, to the edge of pavements. I took the pain to map out Maple all the way out to Mill Street just to verify what I had because of the fact of the one deed which I had from PSC&G. I actually called PSC&G right away office. I spoke to the LS there. He provided me some documentation as to regards to what PSG had. And that's where I got the thing about the perpetual easement. I asked him also, apparently, while I made him understand, Lot 7 was formerly owned by PSG, and I had asked him, well, you're the grantor, could you please provide me with that documentation? And he told me, he never owned that. And that was pretty much substantiated in 1905D, and also by a survey by O'Connor. He had done the same thing on that lot. It was just no back title saying PSG owned that. And bottom line is, once I put this all together, the probably came out that they made reference to the maps of 1897, and the surveyors back then obviously could see the Morris Canal. It was there, it was physically there. So the calls came to the Morris Canal, and as the courts have upheld, if an adjoiner is called out in a conveyance, that call becomes a monument. In this case, the Morris Canal became a monument because it was a part of a conveyance. And that is the most senior documents I've had to work with. So, bottom line, that's what generated the boundaries as I found it today.
Okay. For the record, I think you, both of you gentlemen, provided at least the chairman with your resumes, curriculum vitae.
Correct.
Unless there's a problem, I'm just going to mark those B board according to B1, just so we have the background in writing. What after you did this work, Mr. DeRosa, and after you, Rose, and after you surveyed, what conclusions did you reach? What did you prepare anything for?
Well, we have a map here. Good boy, you're easel. Put it up.
Yes, we're going to mark this B2 as a board. Just so the public can also
That wall is sorry. Okay. You guys need to see this later?
Yes.
Push it back there. Just that?
Let's go back a little further.
Vice chair.
Where there's that open space there. That's it. Now everybody can see it.
Okay, just, if you could just identify the, you know, the subject property and what the red lines mean, and did you mark it as A, B, B2?
Yes.
Very good.
This is the boundary lines as I have found. This is the right way of Brighton. This is lot 8. Coming down the side, to here, this is the township line, or common line between Belleville and lot 8, and it reads to here. If you would, at this point, it reads, point on the Morris Canal, as per D book, T91, page 481, dated 3/30/1937 and the 1932 tax map. This corner here is also part of the PSC&G ownership, which reads to the Morris Canal, same D book and page and year. This one here comes down to the middle, which is a dimension of 231 feet. That there is, comes out as a point on Morris Canal, that's for D book R49, page 390, dated 7/24/1911. Any of the surveyors at the time, they could see the Morris Canal. It's also represented on the 1932 tax map. This corner here, which is a common corner between lots 7 and 8, that also goes to a survey, goes to the Morris Canal, as per D book. We have 5930, page 646, surveyed by O'Connor. Then also 1932 tax map, deed book V38, page 365, dated 6/05/1905. So, I mean, these are in historical documentation. And this also reads to the 1905 deed. Which is more paramount is the fact of this commencement point, which is up in the corners, is where the Morris Canal meets the right-of-way of Brighton. That was part of a map from 1897, and it was done by a surveyor, A.H. Amerstadt, and that was dated November 8th in 1897. That was the point he called out, which these surveyors used as their anchor to create those meets and bounds in that conveyance of these two lots. Given that information and where I am in time, these are the most senior calls there, and they are part of a conveyance. Again, the law says if it's in a conveyance and the meets and bounds are there, that's a monument. It's no different than an iron pipe or whatever. It can't be disputed. And more importantly is the surveyors at the time could see the Morris Canal. I had to go on that. It's the only information we could go by today. That's how I established this boundary.
So you actually went back to when the Morris Canal existed based on the deeds?
Based on the documentation, like I said, the oldest reference is 1897, November 8th of 1897.
So if I may, what you're saying is they made reference to a point when the Morris Canal was there.
Correct.
So you're saying, I don't want to say it's moot whether it's there or not anymore, but the point is still there.
Based on the documentation, which is in the public domain, which only you and I could do today, based on that, is go down that line as that document calls us to do, so, being the most senior in time.
Senior in time in fact, they made reference to a physical monument.
Something they could see.
That is still
something,
there.
Something that surveyor at the time could see.
Still there. So, regardless of whether the water is still there or not, that monument is there. Correct?
That, well, the monument, in a sense, is that the call is a monument to the adjoining. That's just to the Morris Canal. When you measure 231 feet down from Grand Avenue, once you come down that line,
that's it.
That's your, that is a point on the canal.
Mr. DeRose, were you privy to the applicant's survey of the same property?
I saw it, yeah.
Okay. Does yours, does the survey that we're looking at as B2 differ from that one, from the applicant survey?
Yes, it does, but that's his survey.
Okay. Where do you differ?
Well, my boundary comes down here 169 feet,
I think this was 160. Down the middle, he had 220, I got 231, okay? And on the side here, this, I believe he wound up almost same thing I did on the far side of 233 and 247. But again, I looked at it and said, fine, I just did my own survey here, did my own analysis.
Did you conclude that at the bottom of the map, at the bottom of the survey, I'll refer to that as the rear of the building?
Yeah.
What was your conclusion, that there was more land that the applicant owned, less land?
Yes.
More land that the applicant owned?
At this particular, coming down this line, if you have my maps in front of you, you'll see a dashed line coming down to the building, and I called out the meets and bounds on where I got them from, okay? And that would exceed beyond what, actually even going down the fence line, it goes beyond that because of that ancient document from 1911 and 1897 and the tax records.
On those two points, how much more land does the applicant own than his feet, than what we were
that originally? I didn't do that analysis of that particular point. I just took the area of the lot. The differential would be whatever the applicant had put in before.
Okay. I believe on the bottom, you put where the point is to where he's got the fence right now.
Yeah.
10.3 feet.
That's the distance from the corner. That's 10.5 feet from the corner of that fence. Keep going towards Maple. You will come to the boundary.
Okay, so that's extra.
Yes. Yes. At that point.
Now the narrowest spot around the end of the building in the back, according to your survey, is now 15.9 feet.
Is that what it had been before?
No, they were talking about 10.
Okay. So there's about five and a half feet more there, and another 10 feet more on
the other side.
The other side.
Okay. Any questions by members of the board?
Yes.
Let me just use my laser pointer since I'm some distance away. The northeast corner of the building, there are two points identified in the Morris Canal. The first one is dated August 20th, 1970, and then the other one now is dated July 24th, 1911. Are you asserting that the 1970 point is essentially incorrect?
Correct.
That's incorrect.
Because of the senior, the 1970 deed is subordinate to 1911 because of the senior rights of the dates.
Right. Maybe this is speculation on my part, but it would seem to me that if the point you've identified has been the correct one all along, why is it that the back of the building seems to have been rigged or jogged to conform to the 1970 line? If it had been the case that the 1911 or 1932 tax map was correct, it would then seem that the back of the building would have had plenty of space to make it a regular rectangle. They wouldn't have had to arrange the back end of the building to conform to the earthwork at the 1970 point on the Morris Canal.
I have the biggest idea why they did that. You could pull up the site plan when they approve this for a building, you'd have your answer. I have no idea.
It's just curious. It seems like when this building was, and I forget, when was this building constructed?
Around 1971 or so, I believe.
Well, perhaps the surveyor at that time made a mistake and they out of necessity had to arrange the back of the building to conform to that, and had they known the right point, they wouldn't have had to have that somewhat staggered.
I'm a surveyor, I don't speculate.
Probably because they didn't go far back as he did.
Right. They would have had they done that, they would have had a more regular rectangle.
Like you say, you don't want to I'm trying to figure out where there's another bit that's mine. There's not something to understand.
Any other questions by members of the board? Let me ask a question, because with the original plans, there was, I just looked at the original plans, there was like 16 parking spaces in lot number 7 that is going to, and this is probably going to come forward, you're good again from there. How many parking spaces do you feel you can fit in lot 7 on the left side of the building, if you know the answer to that, based upon the plans? Because I know there's a little part in the back that you did say that he was, his fence is there, but it's technically not his. That's the small rectangle, it looks like, on the bottom. Am I correct, Mr. Rutherford?
Yeah, down in this lower area, this is not, it's where the asphalt comes, and actually exceeds, on a map I gave you a dimension from the corner of 16.7 feet going to the fence that is out of the applicant's lands. Okay. That's on the township property.
Yes. So, do you have any idea how many parking spaces can be put there?
Well, let me answer that question by first stating that it, of course, depends upon the engineer who's going to lay this out and how this fits in with the entire site. If we just isolate that one side of the building, there's approximately 32 feet from the building to the lot line. And I'm talking in rough numbers. That would make it, according to the New Jersey standards for residential site plans, there would not be a sufficient distance to allow 90-degree parking straight perpendicular to the sideline.
How about 45 degrees, you know?
Yes, I do. I have to get my cheaters out.
That's okay.
The residential site improvement standards have 90, 60, 45, and 30-degree parking, with which they specify dimensions. 90, there's not enough space. There's not enough space for 60. There is enough space for 45-degree parking. That would provide a 13-foot backup for an 18-foot wide parking space. If you do simply the geometry, how much space is there, you can get about 17 parking spaces along that line. However, you're most probably going to lose one at the entrance, and at least one, maybe two, at the back, because you have to get a car around in order to exit the parking lot. So we're probably looking at, realistically, somewhere around 14, 15 parking spaces, maybe 13. Because that's a difficult turn to make.
Now, the plan technically is to make the turn to the back when you come in.
Yes.
And park at the angle and then exit from Brighton Avenue at the end of lot number 7.
Correct. The access aisle for the new parking spaces would have to be one way.
Right.
And no matter how you look at it, another potential issue to look at is it's going to require a new driveway.
Yes.
And what's going to happen at that location, engineering-wise, construction-wise, is going to depend on how the applicant's engineer designs it.
Can you tell how many parking spaces would be lost on Brighton Avenue by this driveway?
The driveway will be probably one or two.
At least two. Well, to be comfortable, too.
Comfortable, yes.
Okay. All right.
Anything else by members of the board?
I have one more
yes,
question.
Yes, go ahead.
This may not be particularly germane to this case, but I'm curious, do you know if the Morris Canal, as it meandered through Belleville, did it maintain a fairly uniform width, or did
it? To the best of my knowledge and my history of dealing with the canal, no.
All right. Because I've done some online reading, since this case has occupied so much time for the zoning board. There are a couple of websites, the Morris Canal Society in New Jersey, and I also came across an interesting...
One thing I may present to this board, I have seen this happen, it's up to the board, it's your property, but survey I did back up in northern New Jersey for County Concrete on one of the quarries and right next to Roxbury Auto. Roxbury Auto had one of the lift stations of the Morris Canal on it. I had a pretty good idea it was. But in my research of documentation, I did come across that in 1926, County Concrete, which at that time was Hudi, sold property to Hudi. What I'm trying to say is the Morris Canal, just prior to closing, that was in 1926, sold off property. Mm-hmm. So you have to do some research. In the back history of it, you may find a transfer of title out of the canal and banking company.
The other problem you have with trying to determine a width is that over the years, the word width has come to mean different things, especially what are we talking about, the actual water course? We're talking about the water course plus the towpath. And very often when utilities or transportation systems acquired property, they would acquire it to a property line. We see that today with the modern interstate highway systems. The actual right-of-ways for those are meandering. So the idea that there was one width probably is not accurate. Good, nice thinking, but not accurate.
It wasn't very clear, but when I read online from the Morris Canal Society and Scientific American, they just said that initially the canal was 32 feet wide, and then in the late 1800s, early 1900s, it was expanded to 40 feet. But they didn't specify if that meant the towpaths or the other configuration. I just saw those two numbers, 32 feet, and then it was expanded to 40 feet. The initial depth, I think, was 4 feet, and then it was increased to a depth of 5 feet. I was just curious if the Morris Canal through Belleville, if it was a uniform 32, or if it ebbed and flowed depending upon the geography and the terrain in different areas.
Any other questions by members of the board? Any questions by Mr. Gashion?
None, Mr. Chairman.
None. Okay. Questions by members of the public?
Yes.
Mr. Frantoni? Yes. Matter of fact, I want you to come up so we have you on the video, and I want you to give your name and address, please.
This is Frantoni, 129 Mount Prospect Avenue, Dallas. Mr. DeRose, correct? Right. You did these things. Did you enter all these warning and numbers?
Absolutely.
Okay. On these heavy, on this blue line, you entered 180 feet, 0.65. And you wrote survey next to it. You did that.
Yes, sir.
All right, this dotted line here, you entered 164.39 feet, and it also says survey. Did you enter that?
Yes, that's from the surveyor's map.
Okay. Now, on this center line, you also show two numbers.
Turn around.
On the one, you entered 203 feet, and in parentheses, you put D. Mm-hmm. You did that? And right under it, you put 231 feet, and you also put D, and you entered that. All right. You know, I forget what I counted, but somewhere between 11 and 12, you put point on the Morris Canal at various locations all over here. Mm-hmm. You entered those.
Yes, sir.
What did you actually go down here and measure? What did you measure here? You put point on Morris Canal.
This year, I have all these deeds all compiled through. I literally measured right now all the way through. I came to the property here, went down Maple Ave to Mill Street. I physically measured all you see on this map. all down Acme, all these fence lines. So this line down the middle comes from deed documentation and the previous surveyor.
The question is, all these points here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, there's about a dozen. All these points are Mars Canal. What do they represent?
Points on the Mars Canal.
On what basis?
According to the legal documentations of possession, if you would like, would you like a copy of this entire file?
Well, I probably have most of it.
Well, if you do, then why are you asking me this question?
Because
the answers right here. This is the document. Do you have this in quill? You have this one?
Right. Let's go one at a time.
My friend.
What does this mean? Point on Mars Canal.
A point on the Mars Canal. It's a point. On the Mars Canal, point. The call goes to that. You understand how meets and bounds work?
Yes.
How so? How do you understand what meets and bounds are?
You go to a location where there's a legal marker, which right now is on Acme Street and Brighton Avenue. And then you start your surveying from there.
Correct.
I'm a contractor, I'm not a surveyor.
Okay.
But for 43 years, I have to know how to read a survey in order to put an addition or a fence.
So if I said to you a point on the curb or a point on the sanitary sewer line, you would understand that, wouldn't you?
I'm asking you what you got to. What did they mean to you? Where did you get that point?
His answer is deeds. From all the legal documentation.
Okay. That's all I asked.
It's only one sentence.
That's all I want to know.
That's what I'm saying. I'm calling you. Because the reason I'm questioning you is because it says deed.
Well, I'm questioning you.
That's what I'm saying. I'm questioning your question.
All right, gentlemen, let's go back to the question.
And I think I got one other question.
Okay.
You stated over the years, the Mars Canal sold part of its property.
May
have. All right.
I know for a fact of more.
In your extensive research of this particular area, did you come across any of this area from Acme Street all the way to Harrison Street, any record of the Mars Canal selling any of its property in this area? Do you have any of that knowledge?
No, all I did is I focused on this particular area. My charge was to survey this parcel only, not redo all the property on Brighton.
The question. The question was, in all this extensive research you said you did you come across any deeds that showed the Mars Canal and Banking Company, which was the official name of it?
That's correct.
Did they sell any of this property in this area?
Not that I know of.
Thank you.
Any other questions by members of the public? Come on up. Name and address. Full name and address, please.
John Higgins, 102 River Road, Robson, New Jersey. Good evening. We don't really understand two real simple questions for you. Probably help us. Tell us like some of the basic criteria, like the GPS transit accomplishments.
Louder, please. Microphone.
We can't hear you.
Can you tell us some of the basic equipment you used, like a GPS, a compass, a transit, to establish these original points?
This is a TOPCon robotic instrument, 5-second accuracy.
Like a Trimble GPS?
No, it's not a GPS, sir. It's a robotic instrument. Okay. GPS is an entirely different instrument that is used in surveying. However, I do own a BRX5 through a network with KeyNet. I do have that.
Approximately how much time did you spend at the work site?
Spent 2.5 days.
Good. You have an assistant?
Just me.
Just you.
That's why I have a robotic. Don't need anybody.
And about how much time did you spend back at the office on the survey?
Oh, geez, that there you spent better part of 45 hours.
That's pretty good. And at the last meeting, we were sure that all your work would be based only on needs. You researched all the needs?
In this particular area, as it adjoins the property.
Okay. You have the needs with you now? Okay. So we came across some deeds that were not on your list.
Fine.
Would you like to take a look at them?
What do they say?
Well, they say at one point the township of Belleville owned the land. and the dimensions conflict with yours.
What year was the document?
I had documents coming back to 1905.
Okay, I got one here, 1905.
Okay, I have 1905, 1936, 1955, 1960.
No good. They're no good.
But they're not in your...
It doesn't matter, because the senior deed prevails. Everything is subordinate to the senior documentation of 1897.
But your senior documentation doesn't apply to those plots.
This was a map prepared, which I could not find, which I did look for by the surveyor, Armistead, in 1897, mm-hmm. that pulled all this land out. And that was the commencement point for your 1905, 1911 documentation, which was the genesis of these descriptions. So, I don't know if you can find something older than that. I'll gladly yield to it. Not anything younger.
And you went back to 1897?
This reads from 1897. Do you have this document here? This is the R49 book.
Is that the one that's in person?
Yes, sir. We're cool.
I have a bigger copy.
Well, fine. Did you read it?
Yes, I did.
Okay, it tells you right here, 1897. Well, it commences out.
But you got a deed from 1897.
This is a deed.
From 1897?
This is a deed from 19... Oh, this one here is...
1911, right?
Right. And it refers to an 1897 deed. A map. It is in the public domain.
If you had these additional deeds, would it change your survey?
No.
Not even the one with the Township of Belleville, we surveyed the property.
Okay, what a survey. Once again, we've had multiple surveys here, and it doesn't seem people are using the proper documentation.
Well, either that or the original survey is wrong.
Excuse me?
Or the original survey is wrong.
How could you prove that?
Six subsequent.
How would you prove that you were
survey? I'm just bringing up a point. Either the original survey is wrong or six subsequent surveys.
If everything was to be subordinate to the original survey.
The original deed.
The original survey. The deed comes from a survey. What meets the bounds will come from the survey.
You have that survey?
Excuse me?
You have that survey.
But I looked at the 1897 documents, couldn't find it. In fact, the matter you can't even find any surveys on the Morris Canal. Other than what we have in antiquity, as we read these documents.
Now, the Morris Canal was approximately 40 feet wide.
I have no idea.
According to the Morris Canal Society.
Okay, that's what they said.
Do we have any pictures of that? Any photographs of the Morris Canal? The barges that went up and down the Morris Canal were 87 and a half feet long.
Excuse me, sir, I could care less. What they were doesn't mean anything to me.
Okay.
The Morris Canal no longer exists. Could you tell me where it is? Since you seem to be so clairvoyant, could you tell me where it is?
I can point out where it is.
What you're thinking is what you. Where it should.
Yes.
Okay, I am not doing should. I go by these documents. That's the only thing I can do.
I have no further questions at this time.
Okay. Any other member of the public have a question of the witness? Mr. Gascione, do you have any further questions of the witness?
I do not.
Okay, any member of the board have a question of the witness? Further questions? None. Then you may relax. Okay, and we'll open this up then to testimony from the, we only have one person testify.
And that was close.
And she was done at the end of the night. Mr. Frantoni never got a chance to give any testimony, and I believe her brother never gave a chance to give testimony. And anybody else? Yes, all it was questions. So now we're opening up to the public for testimony. Anyone wish to give testimony on this application?
I do. Okay.
Hi, good evening. I'm Grace Higgins. I'm 3A Brighton Ave, Belleville. I have some pictures I'd like to offer you. you want to now come to the pictures now or later as they go, whatever you want.
What is the pictures of?
The property owned by Mr. Calandra.
What is the pictures going to reflect?
Well, it goes along with my words here.
Well, why don't we start with the words?
Well, there are a number of photos. There were a number of photos put in evidence two meetings ago. Are these the same?
These are different.
They're different. Okay.
I'm going to start with...
Could you raise your right hand, please?
Oh, yeah.
This is testimony. With regard to this application, do you swear that the comment you're about to make shall be the truth?
I do.
And you stated your name is Grace Higgins, H-I-G-G-I-N-S.
Yes.
Thank you.
You're welcome. The applicant is seeking variance relief for excessive residential density. The current density restriction for the township is 12 families per acre. The property now has 33 families, which is way past that density level. This would create an even more overly congested property than exists now in a neighborhood zoned for 1 and 2 family homes. At 33 families, the property is at 275% of density. Bringing that number to 41 families by adding 8 units in the basement would put the property at 342% of density. This would be completely contrary to the purposes of the zoning laws, which are to prevent the overcrowding of lands and buildings. The parking proposed for the plan does not bring the levels up to what they even should be with the existing units, and even that cannot be done without a variance to the stall sizes. Mr. Calandra has stated 33 older style units cannot support in the real world the cash flow to do the renovation. And this is from page 171, line 24 from the June 25th, 2015 meeting. But then...
referring to the transcript, basically.
Yes. Okay. It was page 171, line 24. But then stated by Mr. Calandra, quote, "If this makes you feel a bit more comfortable, Brighton Gardens does not have a mortgage on it." That's in Belleville, Harrison Gardens, which I own in Belleville, doesn't have a mortgage. The other apartments I own in Belleville doesn't have a mortgage. I'm not desperate for money, end quote. And that's page 177, line 3. This was also from the meeting on June 25th, 2015. Having said that, he is not in need of the additional units to pay for anything. By his own words, his properties are not hampered by any debt, leaving him only positive cash flow. I see no reason the property density should be so grossly increased and additional burdens be placed on the township and other property owners in the area just so he can have another increase to his cash flow and a no-risk investment. Courts and the Belleville Zoning Board website have made it clear that an inability to make the most profit is not a sufficient reason to justify a D variance based on undue hardship circumstances. By his own words, he has all the money he needs to renovate his existing units and to maintain the property, which has been allowed to fall into disrepair, which is clear for everyone to see. The plans require D1, D2, and D5 variances, along with 14 C variances and or waivers. This for a non-conforming structure that had to have almost as many variances just to be built originally. Remember, this is in a neighborhood of 1 and 2 family houses, and that zoning has not changed. Also, the applicant is asking for variances for what he is calling existing conditions. These are, in fact, zoning violations that he now wants made legal. For these reasons, the application should be turned down in total. Can I just get a drink of water real quick? I'm kind of like...
Yes.
I'll be right back. Sorry. They say people fear public speaking more than death, and now I know why. Okay.
You're doing fine.
Thanks. I would like to address the part of the application that states there will be various site improvements such as drainage, lighting, landscaping, and parking, as stated by the attorney Robert Gaccione, December 4th transcript, page 4. I also object to the proposed variance relief for excessive residential density that now exceeds the current standards by 300%. The application is contradictory because the so-called improvements would be negated by the 14 variances and 3 waivers to ordinances put in place to protect the rights of nearby residents. These include bulk variance relief for minimum front yard setback, minimum rear yard setback, maximum building lot coverage, overnight lighting, minimum required landscaping for parking lots, and minimum required privacy screening in a residential zone. And I would like to refer to these photos, 1 and 2.
I believe we are up to exhibit O for objector 17. O17, if someone could mark one more.
Okay. That was taken by Mary Higgins. Both of those photos.
How were they taken?
August 2015. You want me to put it up here?
I just want to know what you're trying to show.
Okay. I'm going to refer to these now. These show the photo. This is the driveway at the north side of the property. It shows a broken sidewalk that has been like this for years.
Objection, Mr. Chairman. He says no relevance to the variances being sought. We're talking about something in addition to the building that's not relevant to that.
I'm showing negative criteria.
Yeah, I realize it's...
To make this straight, this is the only driveway there is currently.
Yeah.
Okay. Because you said north driveway, so I want
to... Well, yeah, it's on the north side.
By testimony, nobody thinks there's more than one driveway.
Yeah, I understand the objection, but again, we're not bound by the strict rules of evidence, so I think we can hear it and give it the weight that the board feels it's entitled to.
I'm pointing this out because there's nowhere to park because of all the cars from the apartment building parking on the street because they don't want to pay the extra $50 for a second vehicle.
That was already ruled on earlier.
My mother had to park way down the street and tripped and fell right here and broke her shoulder.
I understand that, but...
Okay. Well, the sidewalk was never fixed and it's only getting worse. And I would hate to see somebody else's mother trip and fall and decline.
So, ma'am, to get to the point, what you're saying is hasn't maintained this park.
Right, and what I'm saying is an increase in cars is only going to make this worse. The neighbors and myself can already no longer park in front of our house. Okay. The second objection I would like to make is to the proposed driveway on the south side of the building that would result in more impervious land coverage, lack of drainage, the destruction of existing foliage, and no privacy screening. The proposed driveway would result in the removal of 9 or 10 mature trees, and this is a quote by Mr. Iannelli, page 86, December 4th, 2014 transcript, and all vegetation would be paved over with asphalt. In addition, there would be two or three parking spaces lost on the street because of the curb cut. That's right on a curve. The site plan does not include any positive criteria in protecting public health, safety, and general welfare by requiring the screening and landscaping of the parking lot. There would be no protection against wind turbulence, heat, and noise and glare of automobile lights. The existing pervious land serves as a natural drainage system on the south side of the building. On the north side, abutting my property, where there is no pervious land, there is a constant stormwater runoff into our backyard at the end of Maple Avenue. The trees and foliage should not be removed. They reduce carbon monoxide, they prevent soil erosion. The proposed parking lot would have the negative criteria of lack of visual and sound privacy and do nothing to relieve the stark character of the apartment building and the paved area. The 30-foot strip of land now serves as pervious land drainage, allowing rainwater and roof water to drain off into the ground. In the zoning laws of Belleville 23-3 Schedule of Regulations, it states that an RC garden apartment with an area of 35,000 square feet should be limited to impervious or non-drainable surface coverage of 40% of the 35,000 square feet and a minimum open space of 35% of the 35,000 square feet. The argument was made that since the apartment was in a residential two-family zone and not in a garden apartment zone, that there is no limitation on impervious surface coverage and no limitation on minimum open space. Mr. Stack, Planner, June 25th, 2015, transcript, pages 191, 192. Are we supposed to close our eyes and pretend this isn't a garden complex? This isn't a garden apartment, but it clearly is. The result would be almost 100% of impervious land coverage. There would be no protection from noise, pollution, water runoff, flaring lights from cars or exhaust. No natural barriers for privacy screening would exist. One of the waivers calls for minimum landscaping. There would be no need for landscaping because there would be no land for landscaping. My next objections are to minimum required landscaped areas in the parking lot. Minimum required privacy screening as required in residential zones, parking within 5 feet of the lot line, and parking in the front yard. Here is another photo.
We're going to mark this.
Yeah.
Taken by Mary Higgins, August 2018.
018. Ma'am, you would have to hand that over to the clerk because that becomes evidence as part of the case.
I understand it will be to no avail, but I'll repeat my objection that this has nothing to do with the variance. These are photographs that allegedly depict a deteriorating condition.
I'm sorry, but you didn't know what I was going to say yet. Here is the view from our backyard and from the windows of our house. This is a photo of the apartment building. As you can see, there is no privacy screening. The building looks like a motel right in the middle of a one and two family neighborhood.
Ma'am, when was this picture taken?
August 2015 by Gary Higgins.
Okay, that's being for the record.
Notice the cars parked right up against the building with no sidewalk, which denies immediate access to the building in case of a fire. Notice the air conditioner on ground level sticking out from the building. Does this look like a typical neighborhood in Belleville or like urban sprawl? Because there's no privacy screening and no natural buffer zones that would reduce noise and car exhaust, I have been subjected to the sight and sound of tenants fighting in the parking lot late at night, booming noise from car radios, car alarms going off all hours of the day and night. The increase in population density, along with more cars, no plants, no trees, no shrubs, no screening, is not in keeping with zoning ordinances for harmonious surroundings of adjacent properties. This next photo, also taken by Mary Higgins.
019, I'm assuming your objection is the same, Mr. Gassione.
I'm sorry.
Well, he didn't even see the picture yet.
That's right.
This is taken by Mary Higgins in June of 2015. Last but not least.
Okay.
Just explain what you can do. You can fix without.
Ma'am, what's your 019? Mr. Milano would like to know what that last picture depicts.
I know you were interrupting. I just want to know what you are showing.
Oh, I'm going to show this.
Yeah.
This is to show unsightly holes and cracks. And this is what I have to look at every day because there's no screen.
I don't want to make an assumption on you.
Okay. All right.
I also
I'm showing this to show there's giant holes in the parking lot. There's no lid on the dumpster. Let me get back to.
And you have a commercial vehicle.
At least it's in the lot.
Well, I understand that.
Okay, here it is. Okay, so we have a view of the Calandra truck parked there every day by, I guess, one of his employees who was also a tenant. More cracked pavement and the uncovered dumpster. The garbage truck makes 3 trips a week at 6 o'clock in the morning, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday with loud noise. Please remember that since the town now pays for garbage pickup from apartment buildings, it doesn't mean that they're going to follow the regular 2 times a week pickup schedule due to the abnormal amount of garbage from 33 units that are located in 1- and 2-family residential zone. As taxpayers, we are literally paying for his garbage pickup, and they are also exempt from the recycling laws the rest of us have to follow, or we'll be fine. You notice there's no recycling can here. So you have 33 families who are not recycling, and we're footing the bill for that. We also get to see more than your average number of old mattresses, box springs, and sofas thrown out on the street because of the frequent turnover of tenants. And there's also leaves and debris that are blown over into our yard, along with soda cans and beer bottles tossed over the fence. And in the winter, it gets worse. In the winter, the snow plows come. They plow all the snow from the parking lot right into my backyard. And what comes with the snow? Oil, gas, and worst of all, rock salt. The rock salt is destroying our yard. Every plant that my grandmother planted, that my mother planted, that I've planted, they're all dying. The whole yard is being destroyed. And if whatever snow they can't fit in our yard, they plow it out into the street. Using up, I should have chewed gum. They're using up the little parking that's there is now filled with mountains of snow, which is illegal. You're not supposed to do that. But you call the police and, you know, nothing happens. Okay. Are there any more pictures? Oh, there's one more. Nope, that's it.
That's it.
All right, I just have one more little thing to say and I'm done. Oh, and because of the lights that are on the building shining day and night, we get to see this 24 hours a day. So I would just like to stress again that our zoning laws are to conserve property values, provide visual and sound privacy, and promote a healthful, attractive, and harmonious community. The applicant has to prove a compelling need for all these variances, waivers, and easements, and clearly there is no compelling need outside of his monetary gain. The cost and negative criteria would be paid for by the people on Brighton Avenue and the taxpayers of Belleville for the municipal services engendered by the high density of apartment dwellers on a street with one and two family homes. Firemen, police, garbage disposal, overburdening of water and sewers, and school taxes for school-aged children are already increasing our taxes while our properties are devalued by the lack of maintenance and heavy street congestion. On Thanksgiving Day, nowhere to park, there's a fire truck on the street, two more fire trucks. Apparently, it seems to be a common thing where the firemen are pulled out there for no reason. Thank you.
Well, any cross-examination by Mr. Gashion?
No questions.
No questions. Any members of the public wish to cross-examine this person? No. Okay. You got all the copies, Madam Secretary? Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else? Yes, Mr. Fran Antoni. Come on up. Name and address.
Vincent Fran Antoni, 129 Mount Prospect Avenue, Belleville, New Jersey.
Raise your right hand, please. Regarding this application, do you swear to comment you're about to give somebody the truth?
I do.
Thank you.
Can I put
something on the sure. This or was this a previous exhibit?
This is Mr. DeRose's survey.
All right, so that's
so it's the same survey.
D2, I believe, yes. Okay, this is a copy you obtained, I assume.
Yes.
Same one?
We got it from the building department last week. All right. This you also have, this is the previous survey.
Dated when? Which one? We got like five of them. Mr. Kalin.
This is dated 7/21/2015. Boundary and topographic survey.
Was that from Mr. Ionelli?
It says Scott M. Bleeker. This is the same one that when I questioned Mr. Ionelli, this is the one he referred.
Okay.
That's,
we already have that, so we need to mark it. Okay.
This we got the same one you got in your file.
Right.
Okay. That one. You have it already. The drug distributor piece, there's some notes on there so you can follow me with this.
If Mr. Frant Antoni has submitted something other than those two surveys, I certainly would like to see copies.
Yeah, I agree.
All right, this, what I gave to the council,
can I give them
is the same survey.
Do you mean they're smaller versions of what you put on the board?
Yes, this is just a...
Yeah, but he has notes on it,
right? Well, this is just a copy of the center of the survey, right there.
This looks...
And yeah, then, different side.
Yeah, why don't we... I'm going to mark this one.
Yeah, Mark, put the red and yellow markings on there, what I put on there.
All right. I'm going to mark this 020... And it looks to be two surveys or parts of two surveys, a deed.
So what is
and a deed of August
top the second. Top page is this survey dated 7/21/15. The second page is a survey that Mr. Ionelli testified that he worked off of, dated 14/14/2014. And the third page is a copy of the deed of August 20th, 1970.
Now the third page, Am I not correct that there is a paragraph missing on the bottom?
Well, that, well, took it on an angle. That's the last line, part of the last line.
Because I believe Mr. DeRose has a copy of this in its completion.
I also have copies of it.
Well, then you should give the completed one, not the one where something's left out.
Well, you already have it.
I have this. Right. I've had this, and that's how I found out from Mr. DeRose there was another paragraph.
Well, that's what I said. What happened, I'm pointing out.
And from Mr. Harris.
You have these deeds.
Yes.
The board has these deeds.
Yes.
What I'm pointing this out is just the copy machine didn't have to the last slide, but you already know what it is, but I'm going to refer to something that's in the paragraph before that.
Okay.
So, the, when we have this survey here, first of all,
objection, Mr. Chairman.
Let me ask
who's
going to ask, what he's
going to
say.
Well, it's a whole concept. I thought the concept was the board, out of escrow funds provided by my client,
yes,
engaged a new independent surveyor.
We did.
And that was the survey that you planned on accepting.
Yes.
If you've accepted that survey, why are we going back to another survey?
Mr. Frantantoni?
Because this is the time when the public has a right to submit testimony. And it's my right to submit any testimony or evidence I may have to present to this board for you to make an intelligent decision based on all the facts.
Well, that's why we went out and got an independent surveyor.
Well, that's what I'm going to make a point of.
But you're not a surveyor.
I'm not a surveyor. But what I'm doing is presenting the facts to you that three surveyors have presented to you already. I'm not coming up with nothing new. I'm just going to point out.
Can I ask a question? This is a simple question. The red line that you have on this top sheet, which surveyor put that on their survey?
Well, first of all, for the record, Mr., let me get this on the record.
Okay.
This young lady just testified. Mm-hmm. You gave her extreme courtesy.
Of course.
You let her go on with her testimony uninterrupted except to designate the picture, the right number on the picture.
Yes.
I expect you to give me the same courtesy because I have put together a report that I want to present to you. Now, if you're going to start questioning everything like you've been doing before to me, you don't let me finish a sentence. Now, I have every right to present my testimony uninterrupted. After Mr. Gassion, my good friend Mr. Gassion, wants to object to anything I said or question me, he's entitled to. But please give me the courtesy of presenting what I have prepared.
All I'm saying is that you made a statement.
Mr. Chairman, respectfully, I have to say, whether I agree with his testimony or not, or Mr. Gassion, let me present it like we're supposed to do. We weigh what, we give it the weight that we deem it to be.
All right.
Him.
Please. All right. Let's
give the courtesy to Mr. Chairman.
Realize you're not a surveyor, but
right. Go. Give it the weight.
I'm going to reiterate my objection. I've made objection before. I've been overruled each and every time.
Right.
Now we have a lay witness talking about a survey
and giving
with
his opinion.
Zero expertise on that. And it's the survey that you asked not be used, that you had my client put up escrow funds to hire a new survey.
I agree with you 1,000%. But so, if the board wants to overrule me, there's nothing I can do.
No,
we're not listening to any opinions from Mr. Johnson. He can talk about
what he believes, and we give it the appropriate weight.
What he believes will be his opinion, and counsel just said
we're not accepting a professional surveying opinion from Mr. Johnson.
Right. Listen, with all due respect, I mean, he may be a contractor, he's not a surveyor. And I give more weight to the surveyor that we hired because he was very detailed on how he came up with this picture.
There's got to come a time where something's inadmissible.
Oh my God. Let me ask you,
if Mr. Gassion would let me proceed, he would know what I'm about to say. I agree with the only board member up there who voted no, not to hire the surveyor. There was one board member who voted no to hire a surveyor, and I agree with Mr. Gassion. His client should not have to bear the cost of this other expense, because you've got plenty of testimony and documents before the survey to prove it. All right? So if I can proceed uninterrupted, you know, I expect that courtesy.
Go ahead.
I expect that courtesy. And I also gave you a courtesy of making copies so you can follow me as I went along. And I'll explain where these red lines come in, Doug Gershow, but I expect that courtesy.
But I just want to make clear that this red line is on nobody else's survey.
Well, you didn't even hear me out. You didn't even hear me out.
Okay, go ahead.
And I just want to get something else on the record, which I said before. I am not a licensed surveyor. However, I went in business in May 8, 1972. For 43 years, I built additions, I built the garages, I put up fences. I have to know how to read surveys. So when I go to a building inspector and show them where I'm putting the garage, where I'm putting the addition, and where I'm putting the fence is in compliance with the survey. So I certainly know how to read a survey.
Go ahead.
Now, we get back to this. This is the survey that you were presented, the first one, dated 7/21/2015. And I spoke to you privately and this publicly at the site, Mr. Del Gershow. If you look at these measurements and you follow on there, on the south side, that narrow lot, originally, and a surveyor, which you didn't even know he was a surveyor, Mr. Harris, originally reviewed all the plans that were submitted to you, and he accepted them. There were two lay people, myself and Ms. Higgins, noticed that there was an error on the south side of that narrow lot. It said 267.32 feet survey and 247D. Now, the chairman keeps saying, I want these surveys to go by deeds only. He said that publicly many times. Right. So what happened? You adjourned that meeting. We come back a month or so later, and Mr. Harris, a licensed surveyor, agreed that we were correct. There was almost a 20-foot error on that property line. That's this property line here.
Well, on lot 7.
On lot 7. It was a 19-point-something-foot error, which you agreed. And that was a licensed surveyor acknowledged that we, the lay people, were correct. What happened then at that point, if you look at that, the center line, the dotted line, it circled, the red circle around it, it says 220.44 feet, D in parentheses. Underneath it, it says survey in parentheses, but no dimensions whatsoever on that center line. If you're following on the map I gave, that's this center line right here on the map, and I got the red circle. However, when you go and get the deeds show clearly we have three deeds going back to 1905, and they all say 203 feet. And the chairman has been said many times, I want this based on the deeds only. The deeds, the deeds, the deeds. Now, if you look at this line here, the black line, it goes up to a point, and then it goes down again to this point here. On that line, it says 160.43 feet. The tax map says 160 feet. That's a plus or minus, a fraction of a foot. This line here, if you scale it off, 1 inch equals 30 feet. The 203 feet comes just about to the end of the building, about a foot past it. And when you're doing scale drawings, what I was taught in school, architectural engineering, just the point of the pencil, you could be off an inch or so when you're doing this kind of scale. So we're just a little bit past the building with that. Now, I want to take you to the new survey presented by Mr. DeRose. I asked him a little while ago, under oath, this line, which you all have in there, right? and he agreed. There's two dimensions there, and they both say survey. This center line also has two dimensions. One says 203 feet deep. The other one says 231 feet deep. Your other surveys, Mr. Iannelli, has the one in the center of this, page two of what I gave you, shows 20 feet. You know. So, here's what I'm telling you. You folks on this board have been given a buffet of dimensions from three surveyors. And they says, here you are, pick whatever one you want to choose from. So what I'm saying, I agree with Mr. Gashion, he should have never been forced to pay for the subsidy. Forget the surveys. Forget the surveys, because there's enough evidence to deny this claim, irregardless of these surveys. Now, something, if you look at this, also on Mr. DeRosa's survey and all that, the one of the board members, I think, wrote this up, we're going to bring it up. The most expensive and most practical building to build is a four-cornered building, all right? In this corner, there's a five corners, two inside corners and three outside corners, much more expensive to build. The reason it was done, and the elder Mr. Luciano Calandra was an expert building developer and all that. His son testified what a good man he was. He built up a real estate empire. Congratulations to him. So what he probably did there, and this shows good, the reason it was like that, because if it had been a 90-degree corner, he would have been on the Morris Canal. Now, on the map that Mr. DeRose made, if you can see from there, I got red lines on there. The two, they're relatively parallel. Now, if you look at the Morris Canal, all along the Morris Canal, they're parallel. And we have facts, a fact sheet. I'll give you one copy if you want to label this to the board. It's called Morris Canal Fact Sheet.
Why don't you show Mr. Gassion, please? And then we'll mark it as over.
Mr. Gassion.
That's be marked.
How do you mark it as evidence when there's no record of where it came from?
No, I'm just saying. You would have to look at it, and then we'd have to decide whether to mark it as evidence. It can't be introduced unless it's marked. What is this? Where did you get this fact sheet?
This is the Canal Society of New Jersey. All right?
When? Where? When?
You can get this online.
So this came from online?
Yes. And it gives the dimensions of Morris Canal.
And on what website?
The Canal Society of New Jersey.
The Morris Canal Society of New Jersey?
Mentioned
the original canal was built 32 feet wide. It was then enlarged to 40 feet wide. But the point here being, this is the barges we previously testified were 87 and a half feet long. The Morris Canal.
Wait. There was no testimony as to that. But you mentioned 32 feet and expanded to 40. Is that specifically here or? Wherever else, the Morris Canal. Well, I think we're going to have to see a copy so we know what he's saying.
Chairman, are you accepting this marking it or?
I don't even see it yet.
No,
he's
talking
about it. Well, he's got a copy.
I'm not objecting to the content because I don't know anything about the content.
Can I see what he's trying to put here? Because if I don't know what he's trying to put, how can we make a rule?
How can we know the validity without knowing the source?
Why are you offering this? What's your point?
Well, the point is, members of the zoning board have to make a decision based on the evidence that they see and the practicality of the evidence that they present. But look, Look what I'm trying to do. This is... Mr. DeRosa's survey... Yeah, because there's plenty of other reasons to reject this. Mr. DeRosa's survey shows, on his survey, he shows a line here. And he shows it 164.39 feet in the right survey. This is the dotted line. He also shows this line. That's what. Now that would be practical. From our canal, the lines would have been parallel. Mm-hmm. But look at this. Look at his survey. Look at the survey. Why would he come to a point in the center of the Morris Canal when he's got his own measurements? I'm not giving you measurements. I'm not giving you anything that he didn't present. This is not practical that all of a sudden this point appears in the center of the Morris Canal, now that in his own dimensions are 27 foot.
Are we not supposed to, what survey are we supposed to go by here? I mean, well, this is getting out of control.
The witness indicated that he told us to ignore surveys. Previously.
Right.
You told us to ignore the survey.
I'm after your survey, but I'm after you looked at the practicality, which I'm going to bring up for that. Look at this. It's practical to accept that the Morris Canal lines would be parallel. They wouldn't be. Right here, his own survey shows this cutting it in half, cutting the Morris Canal in half.
I object to this testimony. How is he making that
determination? Mr. Fran Antoni, you just told us in your testimony, ignore the survey.
Right.
So now if we ignore the survey, can we get to more of a meat of some other subject?
Yes.
Because we'll ignore the survey.
And the reason I'm telling you to ignore the survey...
Let's put it this way. Can you get to something besides the lot size?
Yes.
Good. Can we get to it then?
Yeah. Let's follow up. Let me submit this in it. Now this is from the U.S. Library of Congress, all right? This is a picture of the Morris Canal at Wrightsfield and Bloomfield, which is only about a quarter mile away from this site, if you know where the other side of there. Now, this shows...
What is this going to tell us?
This is showing the width of the Morris Canal.
But if we're not going to be bothering with surveys anymore, why are we even talking about this?
Because I'm showing you...
You said don't listen to surveys. Yet you keep on bringing up stuff that's tied into the surveys.
I have to because you were ignorant of a fact. You said publicly, and we have it on the transcript, you said these barges were powered by small engines. That wasn't.
I never said that.
Oh, yes, you did.
I never said it was powered by a small engine.
We'll bring out the transcript. It was powered, but here's the fact.
Mr. Higgins talked about an 87-foot or something like that, barge, but how do we know that? And this is in Bloomfield. Do you have any pictures of the canal on the edge of this property?
Yes. Why
don't we get that?
You see the tall panel?
Who cares about Bloomfield? Bring up those pictures about the guy's property. Let's get to the meat and potatoes here instead of all the nonsense.
I'm submitting these as evidence. Here's one that shows the Morris Canal was no more. There was a towpath next to it, and it was over 40 feet. This is right here, locally. This is another one.
That's in Bloomfield, you said. Huh? We're in Belleville.
It's right down the street. So why would it get narrowed?
Well, then I suggest you bring it to the Bloomfield zoning board, not the Belleville zoning board.
It's ridiculous. We're talking about it here. Just look at this. Do any of you think this is practical? That dimension would be cut in half in the Morris Canal?
We don't know. It's not. We don't know.
Wait a minute. Your expert put it on his map. Your expert that you demanded Mr. Calandra had to pay for put this zigzag line on the map.
That's what we got.
Right. And what I'm showing you is very impractical, and I'm giving you the proof that the Morris Canal needed this, the width for the water and the width for the towpath. And if you want to see one, I've been on it.
I don't care about nothing about the Morris Canal anymore. All I care about is getting to the meat and potatoes of this case and not going on a tangent over something else.
Right. At the September 3rd meeting, 2015, on page 184 of the transcript, Mr. Rabel stated, this is a land use case, It's not a municipal violence case.
Violence? Violation?
On page 184 of the September 3rd, 2015 meeting of the transcript, this is right from the transcript,
September 3rd.
You stated, this is a land use case, it's not a municipal violence case.
Violence, and I agree with you. Violence, correct?
I agree with you, Mr. Rago. Okay. He's 100% correct. This is a land use case. You folks are charged with proper use of the land. As I stated earlier, when Ms. Higgins and I first received the first one, we discovered discrepancies in the deed. All right, we covered that. Mr. Harris, the surveyor, agreed that that was an error and all that. And then I go on, and we have all the deeds. I give you the dates, but you don't want to hear them. That's 203 feet. And I'll go back to what I said earlier.
The deed he's referring to is 203 feet. It's 203 feet plus or minus, as you testified to.
No, but there's also another paragraph that's missing on that deed, on the bottom.
It goes, well, the 203
feet. And he keeps on talking about stuff that's academic. We already ruled on that. Well, not ruled, but we already listened to all this.
You have plenty of other reasons to reject this application. Number one, and some of it, this young lady had testified earlier, was 100% correct. The density is a major thing. On that alone, that one issue alone, this extreme density, this case should be thrown out the window. All right? There's a discrepancy about that. But if he owns 7/10 of an acre, like he's paying taxes on, he would only be allowed 8.4 units would be allowed on there. If he wants to go to 41 units, from 33 to 8, plus 8 would be 41, that would be 4.88% density. If he does have an acre, as he claims, which he's not paying taxes on, that would still be a almost 3.5 density, 350% of density. That alone, you should reject this application. It's much too dense. Because when the density, it was originally 25, it was reduced to 16, then it was reduced to 12. If you look at all those things, the reason it's reduced 12, one of the statements made in one thing was that it would become another inner city, and it's too densely developed. In the application submitted by Mr. Calandra, signed by Mr. Gassion, it said one of the things is for excessive residential density. That you have in your file. That alone, you kill it. Number two, parking. There's not enough parking. This is taken by Mary Higgins this past Thanksgiving, 11/26, on Bryce Avenue. I'll submit this as evidence. It was evidently a false alarm came, and there's the fire truck there. The cars were jam-packed. You couldn't find a single parking space. This car in the foreground is right where that new proposed exit is going to be from there.
What date is that?
Thanksgiving Day, November 26th. Just past Thanksgiving.
Okay, so that's a day that everybody visits everybody.
Huh? Yeah. Okay. What number do you want to give to this?
021, this is a relevant photo.
Yes, it is.
I do not want the record to reflect who took the photo, obvious reasons.
Well, it's marked on the back. Yes.
Okay. And this is depicted to show the parking on the street.
Yes.
Okay.
Well, I think you need to, whether you like it or not, or you're comfortable with it, before the Mr. Gashow, you have to depict and who took the photo.
Yes, we do. I think that's part of the rules of evidence.
You can't say no because she might be a conflict. She took the photo.
And she gave it to him.
What?
Well, that, you know, I don't believe there's a conflict. Number one, she's a citizen.
Mr. Frantoni, let's get past it. I'm not going to delay anymore.
Right.
We don't care about that.
The next reason to deny this application is the parking. It's an RB zone. Yard department bigger park are not allowed to begin. Number one, there's no parking. Many of the homes on Brighton Avenue were built before cars were there. Some of you have visited the site. They have no driveways. They have no garages. They're forced to park on the street. You now have excessive parking. Under this application, he's only providing 61 spaces. This is from his testimony and Mr. Heritage's report. Under RISIS, he's needs 75, so he's 14 short. Under our town ordinance, he has to provide 82. He's 21 short. That is not one or two parking spaces. That is, even under RISIS, that's a very dramatic shortage of parking spaces. And I congratulate you, Board. Last meeting, or the meeting before, you rejected an application on Washington Avenue because of the parking. I think he was only 7 parking spaces short, because it's really creating a hazard in this town, the shortage of parking spaces. This is another reason, on this reason alone, this application should be denied. This is severe, whether it's RISIS at 14 spaces short, which is very severe, or our ordinance 21 short, that's a significant number, and that should be zoned. And the reason is, this is a copy, I don't think I have to submit it, because public record, it's the zoning ordinance of the Township of Belleville, which every one of you as members should have.
We'll take notice of that, that's all.
Right? On the first page on the purpose and all, and it says the zoning, this is a comprehensive plan designed for one of or more of the following purposes. Number one, to lessen congestion in the streets. So based on that, you people swore to uphold the zoning ordinance. Again, just on the parking, you should reject this application because there's severely not enough parking space. The other thing in the application submitted by the applicant, he was rejected. And Mr. DiLorenzo did an excellent job. His letter of denial gave 14 reasons, variances, and 3 waivers that he had to deny it. And he did a good job of denying the application based on all those facts. Basement apartments are not allowed in the township of Belleville. Mr. Ionella's testimony when I questioned him, and also the architect, remember, I asked him, how high will the, from the floor to the sill, the bottom sill of the window bit? He said 54 inches. That's an excessive height for anybody to try to get out. And these apartments are going to be long, narrow basement apartments with only one window on the end. There's no windows or doors on either sides of these apartments. So that should be another reason why it's denied. The rear yard setback, 20 feet, he don't have to be, possibly has 2 feet. Parking, 5 feet of a lot line. In the application, it was stated that's a pre-existing condition. However, Mr. Ionelli testified that they're reconfiguring the entire parking lot to see if they can get more parking spaces. Therefore, it's no longer a pre-existing condition because it's now a new layout of the parking. So therefore, he has to comply with the 5-foot, no parking within 5 foot unless you grant him a variance. That's another severe, very severe variance that's being requested. Because on the south side, you're right up, the one gentleman came here, he's a policeman, he had to work tonight. He's got 4 kids next door. And you're going to be parking these cars right up against his window, which is right a couple of feet from where these cars are going to park in. They testified 12 or 13 cars are going to be parking there. And you don't know who works nights, are going to be coming in and out all hours of the day. So that is not an existing one. Because they reconfigured it, that's a new variance that's got to be given. This variance will cause a hardship to the neighbors. Parking in front yard. Under your zoning ordinance, item number 5 says to prevent overcrowding of lands and buildings. Well, you can't give a variance to park in the front yard. That violates the zoning ordinance. You're overcrowding lands with all this parking in the rear yard, in the side yard, you know, without the lot line and all that. That very dramatically is contrary to the zoning ordinance. Number two, required landscape and parking lots, right? Required screening. You don't have it. I won't go into that because the young lady did an excellent job on doing that. But number six in there is of the zoning ordinance, which you swore to uphold, to avoid undue concentration of population. Now, we have had all the incidents and all that. You crowd all these people in this one area. That's a direct violation of one of the seven reasons for the zoning ordinance and all that. Now, this is all negative criteria. And the young lady, you're saying, why did she present? She presented a ton of negative criteria. This is a copy, which I'll, in case you didn't read, I don't know if that should be in evidence. This is the zoning ordinance.
No, we have the zoning ordinance.
Okay. So everything I quoted from you is from the zoning ordinance.
Yes, it is.
This is also from the Guide to Planning and Zoning Boards by Glenn C. Hines. I think Mr. Rago recognized that's an authority on planning and zoning boards. Under his review, an applicant is never entitled to a variance. The applicant will need to prove special reasons, a balancing of benefits, hardships, negative criteria, etc. Well, you certainly don't have a hardship, as was testified earlier. The negative criteria, the young lady and I presented a ton of negative criteria and all. It also states in there that in the last analysis, a variance should be granted in most cases only if the board, on the basis of evidence, feels that the public interest, as distinguished from the purely private interests of the applicant, would be best served by permitting this proposal. This will not be in the best interest of the public. It would only be in the best interest of the applicant. You have that also. I don't know if you want to copy that. That's in the zoning letter. Well, that about sums it up. So I'm asking the zoning board. I respect you all. I hope you made a good decision on that Washington Avenue property. This is a case where all the evidence that you've been presented is just loaded with negative criteria. And this application should be denied for all these reasons as stated. Thank you.
Ma'am, you already gave us.
I just want to ask him a question.
Oh, yes, you have a right to ask him a question. Based upon testimony.
Yeah. I'm Grace Higgins.
Yeah.
Have you ever been to Saxton Falls? Well, in Saxton Falls, there is an outline of a barn showing it's 87 and a half.
Objection.
I've seen it with my own eyes.
I understand that, but that's not asking him a question based on testimony.
So you never saw the 87 and a half foot chalk lines?
Not at Saxton Falls, but I have
questions out of order, you must sit down. Mr. Gascione, do you have any questions of the witness?
I do not.
You may sit down. Next witness. Name and address.
John Higgins, 102 River Road, Johnson, New Jersey.
Mr. Higgins, could you raise your right hand, please, with regard to this application? Do you swear that your comments shall be the truth, civil?
I do.
Okay, thank you.
I'm going to try to really avoid using the word survey again.
Good.
Okay. However, during our research, we found
a question of
one, two, no, he's three, doing testimony. Four, five deeds that were omitted from this research. From this recent presentation. And with all the confusion there is, we have three excellent surveyors here, including our own Mr. Hertz here. During my research, I found out what all the confusion was due to. Some of my visits now through Hall of Records. Every time we came across this property, the deeds were ripped from the books, and we had to go to microfilm to get them. Mm. And this is one of the reasons there's such controversy over these drawings. So I would like to submit these as evidence as the missing deeds that were omitted from the drawing?
No. You're going to have to submit a basis for this.
The basis is we were assured the new submission would be based on all deeds. One of these deeds is from the township of Belleville, and it's not included.
Mr. DeRose, would you like to review this, please?
I think Mr. DeRose offered the initial testimony. He can maybe comment on this.
I thought his comment was in 1897, whatever it was.
Was the primary.
Deed is the anchor deed.
The senior.
He's saying it was something that was ripped out of the book. I don't know if you
had it. See that.
Why don't you show, could you show these to Mr.
DeRose? Can you show them to Mr. DeRose so we can have?
Looks like it was folded out.
This goes from 16 to 25.
Okay.
In the library. Librarian told us that it's very unusual that every time we go to this property, that all the deeds are ripped out of the book.
Where was this?
That's the County Hall of Records.
That's in North?
Yes.
That's what they told you?
That's what they told us.
Bring him here to testify because